Good evening, and I'd like to call the June meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board to order. Our first item of business this evening will be a review of the minutes of our last meeting on May 19th. Does anybody have any comments or additional items to note? No? Yes, ma'am.
Have to find it. We can have a big discussion of whether we have strived or we have striven. We sprawl. Can't find it right now. Oh, it's on page 2, second paragraph. They have strived to minimize the impact to the wetlands.
I thought it was striven myself, but it's...
Oh, thank you, Steve. So I would like to substitute the word striven for strived, if everyone agrees with that. So otherwise, I would move adoption of the minutes as amended.
Second.
Okay, all those in favor, raise your right hand. Unanimous vote. To start the meeting tonight, I would like to review the correspondence that has been received officially by the Planning Board. And this includes several items along with some which have just been delivered on the podium this evening. Received prior to tonight was a letter from Mr. and Mrs. Strout regarding Zeb Cove, a letter from T. Dunham regarding Zeb Cove, an excerpt from the Maine Townsman regarding the right to farm law, a memo from the fire chief regarding Zeb Cove, a memo from the fire chief regarding the Cantor Lane Morgan Lane application, a letter from Ann Woodward regarding the Lacey Daycare Facility, a memo to the City of South Portland regarding a pending subdivision, and the Great Pond Legislation Needs Survey. Awaiting us on the podium this evening, and now received, a memo from Terrence DeWan and Associates regarding the Zeb Cove application, a letter from Mitchell and Associates Landscape Architects regarding the Cantor Lane Morgan Lane application, which is timely in that it requests a withdrawal from this evening's agenda, a letter from Monahan Leahy, Hushadel and Libby, Town Attorney Michael Hill, regarding the Zeb Cove subdivision, and a memorandum from the Conservation Commission regarding the Cantor Lane Morgan Lane application, and finally a memorandum from Dan Chase of the Conservation Commission regarding the Maxwell Farm Pond application. And that is the total of correspondence received to date. To open the meeting tonight, we'd like to begin with existing business, the first of which is the Zeb Cove subdivision, a request by Peter Anastas for minor subdivision review of a two-lot subdivision located off Shore Road under Section 16-2-3, minor subdivision review, public hearing. But first of all, I think it probably would be in order to have the applicant present us with the current status of the application and new information.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Terry DeWan, landscape architect in Yarmouth, and here on behalf of Peter Anastas, the proponent of Zeb Cove. And what I'd like to do tonight, because you all are aware of the project, we discussed it at the last planning board meeting, is to bring you up to date on the changes that we have made to the project, primarily in response to the comments that we heard from the planning board and discussion that we've had with Maureen and the fire chief. There were a number of items that were given to us as questions that the planning board had at our last meeting, and the memo that we gave to you today that's dated June 16th, as well as the cover letter of May 29th, we hope addresses all those concerns. If you recall, we did have a lot of those items covered already when we met before you last time, but this is, I think, the formal time to review all that data. The first item, of course, was the name of the Gravel Road. We worked with the Strouts, the abutters of the property, because the land, of course, is not, the land the road is on does not fall on the Zeb Cove subdivision, and we came up with the name Robinson Road. We reviewed this with the 911 committee. Originally, we had a slight variation on that. This was the name that was acceptable to everybody. Another comment that was given to us by the town engineer, Steve Harding, is that he'd like to see the location of the 12-inch water line added to the subdivision plan for future reference to anybody that may be locating a home or proposing to locate a home out here. We did note on the subdivision plan that there is a 12-inch water line on the shore side of Shore Road. We have a letter from the Portland Water District to that effect, showing that there is adequate water in the form of a 12-inch water main. So this has been added to the subdivision plan, as well as a note regarding this on the subdivision plan. The next item has to do with the very minor encroachment on the corner of Robinson Road and Robinson Lane, and the Shore Road, rather, is shown as an enlargement on the subdivision plan. This, of course, is a very small wedge of land where the gravel road extends slightly over onto Lot 1. Normally, we wouldn't feel that this is a problem. However, it was brought to our attention. We've agreed to address it. We initially addressed it by a rather lengthy description that has been included as a reference on the general note. As you pointed out in your introductory comments, there has been a memo written by Mike Hill that we received today. If I may paraphrase that, I would recommend labeling the area of encroachment as the easement area, as is currently on the drawing. However, rather than requiring any future owner of Lot 1 to grant an easement to persons legally entitled to use Robinson Road, I would recommend simply requiring a note on the plan that the easement area is subject to rights of others who are legally entitled to use Robinson Road, have an access over and across the easement area. Planning Board's main concern here is that any purchaser of Lot 1 is on notice that others may have rights of access to use Robinson Road over a portion of Lot 1. Anyone who purchases Lot 1 with the above notation would have known that others would have the right to continue to use Robinson Road where it encroaches on Lot 1. This is satisfactory to Peter Anastas, as Michael Hill has recommended to it. Wetland setback is a point that Maureen had talked about with us. The plan that's in color before you now is the old plan. If you recall, the setbacks between Lot 1 and Lot 2 did not recognize the fact that there was this fairly small wetland there. And after talking it over, we felt that we certainly could very easily add a 10-foot setback around that wetland and move the building setback in such a way that the building envelope now excludes that small wetland that straddles the lot. So that's probably the major change between the plan that you saw last time and the plan that's before you right now. I don't think it really affects the buildability of the property. It certainly doesn't affect where the house, the best house site is located. It will not affect the location of driveways or any of the facilities that would be built on either of the lots. Another question was raised by Maureen in her staff report having to do with the building envelope. If you recall, the planning board had requested a roughly 40-foot open space clause added to the deed restrictions. That certainly covers any uses or excludes any non-building uses for that front setback. We have noted on the plat an additional two notes. Note number 7 has been added to read, any clearing of vegetation within the Shoreland Performance Overlay District. In other words, 250 feet back from the mean high water line is regulated by the applicable provisions of the zoning ordinance. In other words, if anybody wanted to do any clearing or removal of vegetation on the water side of the property outside of the setback, that amount of clearing is already regulated by the town. Note number 8 then covers areas outside of the 250-foot and outside of the 40-foot open space area. And we're simply saying in those areas, which are essentially the side yard setback here, and roughly the side yard, the area along Robinson Road. Note number 8 says activities outside the building envelope in the side yard setback and along Robinson Road outside of the Shoreland Overlay District shall be limited to installation of driveway facilities and removal of diseased and dying vegetation. That pretty much brings the planning board up to date with the changes that we've made recently. We have added the site distances on the driveway. We've shown the waterline easement along Lot 2. We've provided you with an original copy of the plat with the surveyor's stamp and signature on it. We've located the utilities on the drawing. We have the letter from the Water District. We've already talked about the Shore Road clearing limit. And I think that's pretty much everything. I did have a call with the fire chief today regarding the comment that he had in the packet. If you recall, he had two concerns. The first has to do with the ability to turn a fire truck around. We have added a note to the subdivision plan requiring anyone that is building on either of these two lots to provide a turnaround that's adequate to turn a fire vehicle that would be acceptable to the fire department. Comment number 2 had to do with clearing of trees along the access road, Robinson Road. That, of course, is outside of our area of concern, our area of jurisdiction, because that's not part of our property. So with that, we'll turn it back over to the planning board.
Thank you very much. The next item I think that we should look at in terms of before we begin our final review of the application is at our last meeting we spoke about the possibility of having a public hearing at tonight's meeting, and just in order to hear any other aspects of information on the project at this point in time, I would like to open a public hearing. Anyone who wants to come forward and address the board has any information or opinions to express, please do so. The public hearing is now open.
Hello.
Just state your name and where you live and tell
okay.
us.
Okay. I am Sandy Benham,
yeah.
And I am an abutting property owner to the Anastas subdivision, and I would just like to bring to your attention and mention three issues that I think should be brought to the attention of the board. First of all, I think you should be aware that there's a property line dispute of significant potential difference as to where my property line abuts the Anastas subdivision property. And the question of the lot line was first brought to my attention by the previous owner who sold the property to Mr. Anastas. And it's an issue that was not resolved with the previous owner but should be resolved before the final subdivision is recorded. The survey plan, which Mr. Anastas has submitted, I don't believe is quite accurate to the extent that it doesn't show the proper dividing line of the two properties. Second of all, I understand that Cape Elizabeth has an ordinance about preserving open space and would like to strongly encourage the planning board to gain a commitment from the owner to preserve the field here as an open space. There aren't many open spaces along Shore Road that it affords such an open expanse, and certainly has significant scenic value to the citizens of the town, and I feel that the planning board which should preclude any development such as tennis courts and swimming pools and other structures within that field. And assuming that someone who would buy the property would want to build down near the water where they have shown the houses on the plan. And number three, in keeping with that view of leaving the field open, I was glad to see that they are proposing to use our private right-of-way for this lot to access their house. But to date, there's been no agreement with the Strouts or ourselves about the maintenance and agreement of keeping that right-of-way in good repair and so forth. And I just wanted to bring those three things to your attention.
Thank you. Would anyone else care to address the board?
Yes, I'm Peter Plum from Murray Plum and Murray in town, and I do represent Sandy Dunham and her husband, who are the owners of this property here. I should not say they. Sandy is the owner of this property here. And my purpose tonight is to give you some better idea of the nature of this boundary line dispute. We, of course, recognize that a planning board doesn't sit as an arbiter of boundary lines, but to the extent that there's a plan here that's going to be recorded as a certified plan, you should know that there's a very substantial disagreement about the location of this boundary line right here. I have, Terry, I'll give you a copy of this. I have four copies, if I could present them to the board and maybe spread them around. Although the plan is in here. This is a problem of quite long duration that had been the matter of a fair amount of discussion with the prior owner, but because nothing was ever going to happen there, supposedly, it never really did get resolved. The plan which you have before you in the form of the subdivision plan shows this line here as the dividing line for the property. The Anastas property being on this side, the Dunham property being on this side. That line is a match line resulting from a prior court division almost 100 years ago now. And the problem that all surveyors, and believe me, there have been several surveyors who have been out there trying to locate this line here, the problem that all surveyors have is that all monuments have been destroyed and no one can basically figure out where that line is. And even the plans that are certified by Haskell suffer the same problem. There's several plans that have been done for the area by the same surveying firm, the Owen Haskell firm, and they all have the lines somewhere different. The Dunham's deed refers to a starting point of this line as being 600 feet from the end of the road here down this private right-of-way. That point is here. So you've got over 100 feet that is in significant dispute here and has been for quite some time. Our purpose in coming to you tonight is to say, one, there is this problem here. We don't ask that you resolve it, quite obviously. What we do ask you to do is to make sure that prior to the time any plan for the subdivision is recorded, that the dispute, to the extent that there remains a dispute, be resolved, or in the alternative, that line be reflected as being in substantial dispute, because it is not an accurate depiction in our view and from the work that we've had done out there of where the line is on the face of the earth. Second issue that Sandy Dunham raised with you has to do with the question of the access road, which we now learn tonight is going to be named Robinson Road.
This is a private driveway that serves today only two houses, the Dunham House here and the Strout home up here. We are heartily in favor of having this right-of-way serve this lot as well, because we don't think it's a good idea to have a driveway up on the road there.
So we're certainly in concurrence with the applicant's proposal there. But we would ask this board to require that as a part of its approval, that there be a maintenance agreement entered into would cover the cost of maintaining snow plowing, all the things you have to do to a private right-of-way. It is an unpaved road that are not in place today. The Strouts and the Dunhams have coexisted peacefully for a long time. Now we have an additional entrant into the whole thing, and that will require, we think, some more formalized way of dealing with the situation. So we would ask this planning board to address that as a condition of any ultimate approval it gives here. The issue raised by Sandy Dunham, so far as this field is concerned, shown as a field, I'm sure you're all familiar with it, is not so much one of the open space ordinance, but as of your own subdivision requirements of preserving scenic vistas wherever possible. And that is a beautiful field that we would hope in the long run would not have houses or anything else particularly on it. And we think it would be a good idea if the planning board could put some cautionary language on the plan about that field. Thank you very much. I'd be happy to answer any questions, as would Sandy Dunham.
Peter, hi.
How are you tonight, Nancy?
How would you suggest we go about determining the boundary line? How would you recommend we proceed?
This planning board has no jurisdiction.
Settle that question.
The two options I suggested to you, I would suggest to you, are number one, that as a condition of approval, no plan be recorded until that line is finally determined, or the proper location of that line. Option number two is to have as a condition of the approval that line is in substantial contention and the location of the line where we think it is also be shown on the plan. Those are two viable options here. You folks don't have jurisdiction to determine a boundary dispute. Your issue is whether the developer has right title or interest here. And there is a significant dispute as to the right title and interest of that portion of this plan.
Thank you.
Yes,
sir. How much land is involved in this disputed?
I don't know.
I can't.
Tom, have you done any calculations?
0.2.
Yeah, I was going to say about something less than a quarter of an acre.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Mr. Plum? Yes, Mr. Chairman.
It's not so much a question, but there's been a specific request, both in the written materials as well as in the presentation, that the planning board consider putting some sort of a requirement that the field be remain as undeveloped or as open space to some extent. I don't know if this is the appropriate time to bring it up or discuss the issue, but I guess I'm having a little difficulty in understanding how the board would do such, get involved in such a situation, since this clearly appears to be an individual lot that would be not part of the common open space of a larger subdivision. Are you implying that perhaps the board should consider something like that, that we would place an easement or request an easement over this property?
No, we're not requesting this board to declare some kind or require some kind of an easement over that property. On the other hand, you have been presented now with a development plan that shows the location of the home and the location of the driveway, which, as currently configured, certainly acknowledges the spirit of what we're talking about here tonight. And it seems to me that the board can say that it desires the location of the house to be in that general area, and it desires the location of the driveway to be in that general area. to say that you're going to effectively condemn the property for some purpose. I don't think you could do that, and we're not asking this board to do that. On the other hand, it is an important issue.
Well, at least two of the issues I heard raised were, one, the construction of a tennis court, and the tennis court ideally would be in the flatter and more open portions of the site. There may be other issues in the proximity to the house, and the swimming pool is the other one. The swimming pool could be almost anywhere, but it would require extensive clearing for the sun. It may be perhaps better between the house and the ocean to enjoy ocean views at the same time. It's I think, quite unusual, and people agree. I think people certainly sitting in this room this evening, for the planning board to take a single-family lot like this and to put restrictions on the lot as part of a subdivision approval that would prohibit a use, particularly when, I guess, Mr. Anastas, if he wanted to volunteer, might volunteer. I think what we're discussing in terms of the asking price for these lots, and if the applicants have a suggestion as to how the planning board might do that, or if any other board members or the planner would have a suggestion as to how we might do something like that without severely infringing upon the property rights of the purchaser of the property. I guess there's an advantage here is that, as far as I know, no one's purchased the property yet, so when they are buying it, when they do purchase it, they would understand that there may be some restrictions on it, but it's quite an unusual request.
We're not asking the planning board to prohibit those uses on this lot. It's a private lot, and they're entitled to have the uses. We are requesting that the planning board require, as a condition of its approval, that the location of the house and the driveway be roughly as shown on this plan. I don't think that's an unusual request. The second request we make is that the developer be sensitive in placing amenities on the lot, or the owner of the lot, whoever it may ultimately be, whether it's the developer or someone else, to preserving as much as possible that open space field there. We know we can't take it from them, of course.
I'm still at a loss as to how we would ever, without specifically putting a restriction on the approval and getting the applicant to agree this evening that they would restrict certain portions of the site for accessory uses. I fully appreciate the importance in the visual aspects of this lot, and I don't disagree with the desire to have some open space preserved and visual access to the ocean preserved, if indeed there is access there. But we're in a bit of an unusual situation here because we're dealing essentially with a single lot.
Well, I think that would be a good topic for our discussion at the close of the public hearing then. Any other questions for Mr. Plum, as long as he's here? Okay.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yes,
thank you.
Would anyone else care to address the public hearing?
My name is Peter Anastas. I'm the owner of the property. First of all, Nancy, I think your question was right on the money. It was the same question I've been asking ever since I heard about this, I put in quotes, dispute. How do you suggest we resolve this? Strangely, all I ever get is no one knows where the line is. Why don't we just compromise or give me some land here, and then the line goes right up on the waterfront property. I'm happy to resolve any dispute. I have title insurance. I mean, I don't really want any land that doesn't belong to me. It's a relatively small amount of land. Show me a survey. We have two. When I bought this property, Mr. Robinson told me that he was having this problem as well and that I should check into it. I checked into it. There was a survey done by Owen Haskell that clearly stated where the line was. Not just to be sure, I had another survey commissioned. They came back with the exact same result. I have a warranty deed. I have title insurance. All the attorneys for the banks on both sides of the property agreed that this is where the line was. Mr. Dunham came and they said that they thought that the line was someplace else. Show me a survey. I put it in writing. I asked for a survey. I just don't know what I should do. I mean, it's, as a landowner, you just don't turn over land because somebody says, I think I own the land someplace else. The 600-foot argument is easily explained. It's 600 feet exactly as the crow flies, right to the butt to Shore Road. There's nothing in the deed that says it runs along the road. And as you know, over a couple hundred years, a road can change quite a few places. I don't know what I'm supposed to do. I mean, I might have been born at night, but I wasn't born last night. I just can't. I'm having a problem with this, and it's not that much land. It's just a difficult sort of thing to handle. This isn't even a survey. This is a topo plan. That line isn't meant to be an exact plan of where the line is. I called Maureen when I realized this could be a problem. I told her that it was out there. And in my other further research, found that the board has had similar problem like this where someone actually did have a survey on the Fitzpatrick piece, I guess, a while ago. That those people actually did go to the trouble of getting the survey, and they had a disagreement. In that case, I believe the board said that the applicant fulfilled his requirements by bringing in a stamped and embossed survey and whatever else is required. And I think that's clearly what we have done here. If I have a dispute with them, I'm happy to deal with them. And if they bring me anything, just show me something. I'll be happy to deal with it. I could go on and on. I mean, the people on the other side had a similar problem with the Dunhams. I mean, when it, and once again, no survey, no anything, and they finally closed on that piece, I think, Strout to Haven or whatever. I don't know what else I can do at this point. I guess I'll ask my lawyer to address any technical things on it. Beyond that, on the field, what we felt we've done is have three, Mr. Robinson and myself had the same vision for the property, three estate lots. And lots this large and this, frankly, expensive. I don't want to put any more restrictions on them than I absolutely have to. I think these people are going to want privacy as much as anyone, but I do not want to put a restriction on the field. If you'll note also that we do have that strip along the road now that we've enlarged that will be growing up, so to speak, so that that will block a lot of those views anyway, and that is going to be further increasing the privacy. The maintenance agreement on the road, I'm happy to enter into any maintenance agreement that the Strouts and the Dunhams have. I can't control that. If they don't want to let me in to do that, you know, I can bring the road in, the driveway in off the road, off Shore Road, but that's not really, I don't think they really, we gain anything by that, but I'm happy to contribute to the road or whatever is my equal share. Thanks.
Anyone else for the public hearing?
My name is Warren Turner. I'm Peter Anastas' attorney, and as Judge McNichol knows, no lawyer can let the other lawyer have the only say in the proceeding, particularly when you're not in front of a court and haven't done all your homework. And with all due respect to Peter Plum, what Peter Plum has presented to you tonight is a topo map from 1986 that somebody who has not signed the plan has drawn a couple of lines on where they would like the property line to be. What we have, contrary to what Peter said, is we have a 1997 Owen Haskell survey that is signed and sealed as to the location of that line. It is exactly where it is shown on this plan. There is no doubt in the minds of the Owen Haskell firm where that line is. Owen Haskell did some work in the 80s on other Robinson property, had a line for this boundary line that was not surveyed, labeled as an approximate line. 11 years after they did that, they did the full field survey, came to the conclusion that the line is right there. Peter Anastas redid their work completely with another licensed surveyor, and it is his work, Reggie Parker's work, that you see in front of you tonight, that is literally on all fours with the Owen Haskell work. We have asked in writing, I think Peter said more than once, I think it's been five or six times, give us any evidence that you have from a professional surveyor who has sealed the plan that shows that that line is anywhere other than where we've shown it on the plan that is before you. And we'll be more than happy to discuss with you an appropriate resolution. I think, to answer your question, Ms. Masterson, that's the way to do it. In the absence of having presented any evidence other than a topographic plan, which has no bearings or seals or signatures on it, that we've done all that's required of us. If we have a boundary dispute and it's subsequently proved that we do, that's our problem. It's not the planning board's problem. And in the absence of any evidence to the contrary that is professionally sealed, I think that you should go with the plan that you have in front of you. No notes on it indicating the neighbor's claim. If they want to file an affidavit in the registry, let them do that. I don't think you should force us to acknowledge a claim for which there has been no evidence presented. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Would anyone else care to speak? Further comments or opinions on the application? Mr. Plum.
Address specific remarks that Mr. Turner has just made in detail. That's not really an issue before you tonight. You have to assume, I think, that the governor's come before you in good faith.
Mr. Plum, if you'd like to, just step to the podium and we can...
Apologize for not being on the tape there. I think you have to assume that the Dunhams come before you in good faith with their problem here. And while this is not the place to try a quiet title action, quite obviously, you should understand that that some of the statements that Mr. Turner made are not entirely accurate. Starting right with the description in the Dunham's deed, which I have before me, it runs 600 feet from the road down along the side of the road to a point, 600 feet. Now, secondly, the Owen Haskell plans, and we have them all here if you'd care to look at them, do in fact rely on an older survey, and that division line, which is what we're talking about here, is presumed, to be accurate. When Mr. Haskell went out there to check where that line really was, there are no markers to establish that line. Now, the Dunhams have just bought another lot right out of the Strout property. And in doing that, of course, more surveys were done trying to find where all those lines are. The way that survey came up showed the line in a completely different place. Or I shouldn't say completely different, a substantially different place. And so we're saying to you, sure, that is not a survey. I can't come stand in front of you and say that that's a signed and sealed survey. But every survey that's been done comes up with something different. Now, do the Dunhams want to go and have a lawsuit about this? Of course not. Nobody does. It's long, expensive, and everything else. And so we went to Mr. Anaskis early on and said, you know, this has been kicking around for quite a while. He knew about it and said, let's do something. And Mr. Anaskis has come back and basically said, well, I have title insurance and I want to be able to claim against my title insurance. Well, that isn't going to solve the problem either. What is important to the planning board here tonight in considering this subdivision is that there is a substantial issue over a small piece of land affecting Sandy Dunham, where there is not, in our view, adequate right, title, and interest for this planning board to approve the line as shown on the plan before it. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
May I ask you another question, Peter? With the uncertainty about that line being an encumbrance on the Dunham's property,
it's
if they should want to sell?
Yes, to the degree that there are
setback problems with this house here.
That's a carved out lot where the house was. While it would appear from the Dunham's analysis of this and their surveyor's analysis that we have adequate setbacks on that house, on the line that the developer is showing you, the answer is no, we don't. So the answer to your question is yes, to that degree.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Would anyone else care to address the board?
I don't want to get too far into this, but I'm the one who said the 600 feet, not Warren, first of all, my attorney. I was trying to find it quickly in the deed again. I have the deeds right here as well. I'll find it before the meeting's over, but I couldn't find it quick enough. Once again, I'll just say the same thing. I mean, it just show us a survey for crying out. I mean, this is absurd. I'll also refer to a plan that's actually even more interesting than this. Is the plan the Dunhams put in for their septic system 10 years ago. It's shown, it says, property line data taken from plan supplied by owner, which I've yet to see. This plan, which was signed by BH2M as well as Mr. Dunham, shows the property line exactly where I show it to be as well, which I'd be happy to show the board, or if you want, you can pass it right down the line. It's the same thing, it scales off 20 feet. And it's the same thing that I have it as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Is anyone else interested in coming to the podium for the public hearing and offering some comments? Seeing and hearing none, I'll close the public hearing. And we can now begin board discussion. We can still ask questions of people and probe further. But members of the board, what are your feelings on this? Yes, Tom?
At this point, I would prefer that the board not discuss the property line issue any further and let the applicant and the abutters deal with it privately. We went through this, as Mr. Nassis pointed out, we went through this with the Fitzpatrick application. And I don't know how they resolved it, except for perhaps rather than going to court, Mr. Fitzpatrick took the more conservative interpretation of where the property line was and built the houses accordingly. I'm not asking that anyone do anything like that here, but clearly we could get lost on this issue for several minutes, and it's just a waste of our time to even be concerned about it. It doesn't substantially affect the application, and it's a legal matter to be resolved between the two.
At this point in time, I guess I would direct a question to the applicant. From what we have before us, the adjustment of the building envelope, any number of dozens of feet, one way or another, has no impact on the plan that is submitted to us in terms of the development of the parcel. Does the sort of vagary of where that exact, you know, corner of the building envelope is, does that form something that is an integral part of this application? No. Okay. So although the house is probably somewhat flexible, it is intended to be in the approximate location where it is now, sort of not over toward that corner of the parcel. Okay. Is there any other comments on the boundary line issue? Because I think that's a fair appraisal from Mr. Emery at this point. Does anyone on the board have any appraisal of the what the intent is of open space preservation, which is our role in one form or another? I think Mr. Plum was correct to point out that one of the in the purpose statement for our zoning ordinance, we are required to promote the health, safety, convenience, and general welfare of the inhabitants of Cape Elizabeth by not adversely affecting scenic or natural beauty of areas, vistas, aesthetics, habitat, or historic sites. But at least in my interpretation of the ordinance, that is sort of directed to the public at large and their perception of how subdivisions are designed. And I'm not sure that this is even a subdivision design issue. Yes, Tom?
Well, I guess the two questions I would ask to further that discussion is, one, is this particular property listed in the visual access study? Is there any mapping of this area for particular protected habitat or animals or plants? None known. My real strong sense is that it's never too late, but the issue is now before the planning board. I think the issue would have hopefully been between the seller and the buyer, or a generation ago, or two sellers ago, whenever, that a family would have, an individual or family or whatever, a corporation would have felt the importance of this open space to the general area or to a particular lot or to a particular house, and would have taken measures, conservation easements or whatever. I think it's terribly difficult as a planning board member to arbitrarily, out of all of the valuable properties in Cape Elizabeth and one that isn't particularly or specifically mentioned in our visual access study, to say this more than any other deserves further protection by the planning board. So as much as I'd like to see this preserved as open space, I'm not even sure that there's any reason why someone wouldn't want to put a house in here, other than, I think, one of the greatest assurances we can have is if there's any restriction to further subdividing of the property, because that would certainly provide for a nice open house lot. But unless there's a covenant between the two properties that putting a tennis court or a swimming pool or a studio or something out there, or bocce court or anything like that, a putting green would be inconsistent with the character and the value of the two properties, but I don't have a sense that that's the case. I guess the only thing that I would suggest is either the land trust or the Conservation Commission either meet with Mr. Anastas or with the future owner of the property and encourage the preservation of open space. But I don't feel as though, as a board member, I want to put any further restrictions on the parcel.
Mr. DeWan.
Just to respond to that one point, just to reiterate a point that Peter made in his presentation. If you recalled, last month we had a note on the proposed deed restrictions that gave us the ability to give the lot owners the ability to cut trees that were less than 4 inches in diameter. We have since changed that, that says no tree or shrub shall be removed except to allow for access to the parcel, utility insulation, et cetera. The implication, of course, is that ultimately it's the trees along Shore Road that the planning board is most concerned about, and that ultimately those trees will become thicker. The shrubs will be allowed to grow up. There'll be more of an opaque screen created along Shore Road, and that any activities that happen within Lot 1 will be screened by this 40-foot setback from the edge of Shore Road.
Moving on, does anyone have any comment that they would like to address to the road maintenance issue that affects this lot? At this point in time, perhaps the applicant can help me. We have a proposed driveway location shown, but we don't have a restriction, if you will, in the plan that the driveway must be in this location. If in the future, for some reason or other, it were not possible to locate the driveway were shown and the driveway had to come in from Shore Road, would that then, in the applicant's view, be something which would then enable a further submittal to the planning board?
The way the language that I just read to you is structured, it allows driveways to occur within that 40-foot open space easement area. So our way of looking at what we've submitted so far allows people the ability to come in right here, which is the logical point. There's an opening of the tree line right there, but if that for some reason was not available, we do have more than adequate frontage along Shore Road.
Okay.
Okay. Just one little question. What is the date on the final plan that we're supposed to be looking at?
The plan is dated today to Maureen.
That's not their plan.
We submitted copies of both the subdivision plan and the subdivision plat. The plat would be the recording plat.
The plan that I received in my package was dated 5/29.
That's it.
And I'm missing some notes or something on my plan. Is it stops at number 6?
It's the other plan you didn't get.
I guess there was another plan that I didn't get.
I believe Mr. Parker's package had 2 copies of the site plan and no copy of the recording plat.
Okay.
two plans that say 4/6/1998. Are we talking about the same thing?
This is what you should be looking at right here.
Yeah, next to 4/6 to the right, one should say site and the other should say plat.
So yeah, but what about the
they date? Look exactly the same until you...
What about the date?
And the date's the same also.
Be sure you're looking at the revision date paragraph and not the date the plan is done.
Well, where is that?
Right down here. At the bottom. We also have a different date here.
I guess I don't need this thing.
Just to clarify a point, we, because a lot of these discussions have been ongoing, we've revised the plan today in response to some of the comments that we've heard from the fire chief and Maureen. Maureen is the only person that has the most recent plan, the one that will be approved by the planning board, we hope, and recorded at the registry.
I guess at this point in time, in terms of how the recording procedure works and up-to-date plans and whatnot, Maureen can offer us some insight on this.
Okay. The memo you have for me is a review by staff of the plans that were in your package, unless for some reason you didn't get one of the sheets. The applicant has submitted a plan to me this evening, which purports to reflect a lot of the changes, and I believe the applicant did that in order to show their good faith intent to comply with all these changes. However, they haven't been reviewed by staff. Obviously, they haven't been reviewed by the planning board. If you are looking at considering some kind of motion for approval, my recommendation would be to add conditions, even though they've been shown on the plan that's on that I've been given this evening, because staff haven't reviewed them. The conditions in the memo that I've written have a couple of issues. One of them is the issue of how to regulate activities outside the building envelope. The applicant has asked that for the portion of the lots that face, that are within the shoreland zone, they do not want to be restricted to only being able to remove diseased and dying vegetation. They want to be able to remove as much as they would be allowed to remove under the town's shoreland zoning requirements. The other outstanding issue is the issue of the encroachment of Robinson Road on Lot 1. And my recommendation to the board would be to merely add any condition of approval to require that the plans be revised to reflect the town attorney's letter, which was on the podium this evening. That way the final language can be worked out, and the basic intent of the town attorney's letter is there would be a note added to the plan that says that that road can stay exactly where it is right now. Are there any questions?
Is there any issue with respect to approving a plan that hasn't been submitted within the prior, within the submittal time required by the meeting?
Well, you haven't seen the plan. My recommendation would always be not to approve a plan you haven't seen. Further, not to approve a plan that your staff hasn't seen. So I would recommend that even though the applicant has demonstrated a willingness to comply with many of the conditions that have been proposed, that I would still attach those to any motion for approval. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. But what I'm understanding is that we're actually approving the plan dated May 29th, 1998.
That's right. That was the submission deadline for tonight's meeting.
I have one further question. The plat plan shows the boundary and any covenants, restrictions, and notes that are required by the planning board and would carry the planning board's signature. But I don't see anything that reflects without going through it thoroughly, reflects, or is there a reference made to the other drawing that shows the suggested house locations? The issue is that there's been, I'm not going to call them promises, but it's been indicated that these are indeed the preferred house locations, and it's not unreasonable to expect that if someone were to develop this property, that one would find the house closer to the ocean than in the open field. But I guess I'd like somehow to understand as a planning board member that there'd either be reference to this plan or that someone purchasing these properties would have the benefit of having seen these plans in addition to the plat.
If you recall, the subdivision plan with the contours and the suggested house locations, drivers, and so forth was done at the request of the planning board to show how drainage work on the site, erosion control would happen, and so forth. There is no reference at this point between the plat and the plan, other than the fact that the building setbacks describe the building envelope, and clearly, as we've heard, people are free to build anywhere within that building envelope that they may see fit.
So what you're saying is that you really don't have any control over where the house is sited.
If you wanted to buy that one of these properties tomorrow, you may find that, you know, that's the best place or back there, but, you know, based upon walking the site, looking at where the level land is, et cetera, chances are people are going to build probably within, you know, 30 or 40 feet of each of these rectangles that we've shown down there. And that's true of almost any piece of property that you approve. There's a rectangle within which you should be able to build a house.
Put forward a motion. If you don't like it, you can turn it down. Findings of fact. Peter Anastas, trustee of Joe Schmo Realty Trust, is proposing a two-lot subdivision located in the area of Shore Road and Robinson Road, which requires minor subdivision review under Section 16-2-3. The Portland Water District has determined that there is adequate water supply for the subdivision. 3. The existing location of Robinson Road encroaches onto Lot 1. 4. A building envelope has been established for each lot that is intended to limit development in buffer areas, wetlands, sensitive shoreland, and other areas of the lot. The application substantially complies with the standards of Section 16-3-1, Subdivision Review Standards. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Peter Anastas, trustee of Joe Schmo Realty Trust, for minor subdivision review of Zeb Cove, a two-lot subdivision located off Shore Road, be approved, subject to the following conditions. 1. That a note be added to the plan stating the location and size of the water line in Shore Road. 2. That there be no illegal encroachment of Robinson Road onto Lot 1. 3. That a note be added to the plan that states activities outside the building envelope shall be limited to installation of driveways and utilities and removal of diseased and dying vegetation. 4. That building envelopes for Lot 1 and 2 be revised to establish a 10-foot buffer around the wetland that straddles Lot 1 and Lot 2, approximately 300 feet from Shore Road. And 5. That the subdivision plat shall not be recorded until the above conditions have been met.
Thank you, Mr. Carter. Any discussion of the motion? Well, Mr. Amory.
Condition five, can we say that the subdivision plan shall not be recorded until the above conditions have been reviewed by the town planner? I mean, you will review the plan, make a determination that it meets the intent of the approval, could bring it to the planning board, we'll sign it, and then it'll be...
I promise I won't bring you a recording plat and ask you to sign it until all these conditions have been met.
Okay.
So we don't have to add that?
Let me ask under the findings of facts under item four, with reference to the building envelope, at the very end of the paragraph or sentence, and other areas of the lot, what specifically are we talking about in terms of other areas of the lot?
When I drafted that, typically what the board has always done with any lot is we've created a building envelope, and that's been useful for many reasons. The primary reason is it tends to create a vegetative buffer around the living area, and it puts somewhat of a burden on each lot owner to do that, so that no one lot owner is responsible for maintaining the privacy of the entire subdivision. And that's what I meant by other areas. In addition, we tend to change the buffer. Typically, the building envelope runs a set distance from the property line. Until you run into some kind of distinctive natural feature that you also wish to preserve, such as a wetland or a stand of old trees, and that's when the building envelope tends to deviate from the property line and move away from it a greater instance. So the other areas of the lot would be areas where you're just establishing a vegetative buffer and there isn't necessarily a specific natural feature you want to preserve, such as a wetland or old trees or sensitive shoreland. And I would like to point out, before the applicant jumps up, is that they have called me, and this is one of the conditions that they very much would like to see changed. They do not want to be restricted from removing any vegetation that is not diseased and dying in the shoreland area. They would like to be regulated by the Shoreland Overlay District standards in that particular portion of the building envelope.
But again, my understanding is that the building envelope will include a 10-foot setback line from the wetland that straddles the two properties?
That's right, and that was the condition that was drafted in this memo, reflected the previous plan where that was not the case. The applicant has since submitted a plan that does create that setback, but I would just still leave it in since you haven't seen the plan.
Just so there's no confusion, sometimes when a drawing is presented to the planning board or put up on the on a bulletin board, there's a, as in this case, is a shaded area that says a possible building area, and sometimes there's even an area around that that is shown as a limited clearing. But the building envelope primarily is the comprised of the 75-foot setback, the 20-foot side yard setback, the 40-foot buffer left at Shore Road, and then the frontage along the gravel road. So a building could go anywhere within those restrictions.
That's right. The plan you have two plans, and the applicant could get a building permit for a building anywhere in the building envelope. They have submitted a second plan that suggests where they think the house will be located, but that plan does say that those locations are for illustration purposes.
Okay. Thank you.
So other than the buffer areas, there's no limit in the shoreland zone, there's no limit to cutting on these two lots at all?
Correct.
I think that's something that I've noticed that sometimes gets kind of confusing sometimes, that a buffer is a no-cut, no-fill, you don't touch it sort of line. And a building envelope line means you don't build a structure there. And we've extended that in the past for structures to include septic systems and things that require major amounts of disturbance. But traditionally, within the letter of our zoning ordinance, the building envelope is for the building. It doesn't mean we necessarily can't go out and do little bits of improvement to the landscape, as long as you don't cross over the boundary line. And I think the applicant in this case, by volunteering to these conditions of doing nothing except diseased and dying trees around on three sides of the property has actually gone further than what is required by the zoning ordinance. Although the 10-foot setback around the wetland area I believe it seems like the intent of that is more for that to be a buffer and not a building envelope, that that is a no-cut, no-fill type of line, if I'm correct in that interpretation. Is that your understanding of how that works?
Yeah, and I think that in that particular situation, that's so far removed from the possible building sites that it's highly likely anything would happen there.
Okay. Yes, Tom?
I'd like to have a couple of seconds of discussion about the issue of what, first of all, I guess diseased vegetation could be easily spotted. Dying vegetation is something that's a little more difficult to determine. And a lot of lake lots in Maine have a lot of dying vegetation that turns into lawns very quickly. What is the issue with not just simply using the shoreland standards that we have for clearing within the shoreland overlay district or within the setback? Is that not rigorous enough rather than, I mean, I've heard people talk and they, you know, they'll go around the yard and point out all the dying trees and give you a wink and a nod, and it may be that we could be better served by using the standards in the ordinance rather than trying to make a determination whether a tree's dying or not, particularly after what I saw happen with the ice storm last winter. Any tree with a broken branch was a dead tree.
The reason it's in there now is in the past, we've had the building envelope delineated on the plan, and sometimes we haven't gone forward and actually described what's allowed inside and outside the building envelope, which leaves the code enforcement officer in a difficult position when he's trying to determine what exactly the board meant by what can be happening inside and outside of the building envelope. So we've been trying to be more specific and not just calling it a building envelope, but actually defining either activities that are occurring inside or activities that are occurring outside. This is the standard definition we've used. There's nothing that says that we cannot tailor it more carefully to reflect the fact that these are oceanfront lots.
I would prefer to have either that item amended to state that the area within the shoreline setback and shoreline overlay shall be determined by the ordinance requirements.
I would second that change.
I would agree with that also, and perhaps just for the benefit of everyone at large, I can't say what exactly is involved with that, but within the shoreland zoning ordinance, by and large, you're not allowed to really clear as one would think of clearing. You're allowed to take out a certain ratio of very small caliper trees if you want to, for instance, make a path down to the water, but you're not really allowed to open up vistas or anything like that, and it's a very complex formula based on caliper sizes of trees and quantities and percentages of trees, and you need to leave the vast majority of them still standing, I believe. Without getting into the total nitty-gritty of it, if you want to make a little path, you can, but you cannot just blow out a whole vista, even one that's 50 feet wide, I believe. It's just not possible.
I would accept that amendment.
Okay.
But as a practical matter, I think we all know that if someone is determined enough, that vista will be opened up over a period of time, and trees will die from one reason or another. So I probably shouldn't really spend much more time on the particular issue.
Okay.
Well, at least if we make a specific reference to the ordinance, code enforcement officer has something to refer to. Talking about marine oil spills along the shore and those sorts of things.
Well, you know, bags of rock salt. Yeah. Above foods.
Any other discussion with regards to the motion?
One final point, I guess, is the second point, making reference to Mike Hill's letter regarding the encroachment onto Robinson Road.
Okay. Let's see. We have a motion which has been seconded. It has been proposed by amendment, and the proposal for amendment has been accepted. So, Therefore, at this point in time, all those in favor with the motion as amended indicate by raising your right hand. And it's unanimous. Thank you very much.
Sure, you want this land back. Peter, that's your stamp plan.
Oh, is this yours, too? No. No, I don't have it. I get back to,
Maureen.
Get your receipt.
First. Because it really does.
Okay, can we just pretend you didn't give these to me, all right? It'll be a lot simpler.
Our next item on the agenda this evening is the application for the OmniPoint antenna site plan. A request by OmniPoint Communications for site plan review and an RP3 permit to add an antenna to an existing tower located at 351 Spurwink Ave under Section 19-9 site plan public hearing and Section 19-8-3 RP3 permit public hearing. If the applicant could step to the podium and give us some information about what's in the plans.
Good evening. My name is Peter Cook. I'm here on behalf of OmniPoint Communications. We are here to comply with site plan review and request an RP3 permit to add the telecommunications, a wireless telecommunications facility to an existing tower at 351 Spurwink Avenue. As the board may recall, the property currently has a 140-foot existing tower. We're mounting three antennas to that tower. At the base, we are adding two equipment cabinets. One is a small power protection cabinet, which has the electric feed to it. The second is a approximately 3 foot by 5 foot by about 6 foot high equipment cabinet to be mounted on a concrete slab at the base of the tower. That equipment cabinet essentially consists of the radios connected to the antenna via coaxial cable. And as promised at our most recent meeting in May, we had a photo rendering done, which we'll pass around through the board, which gives you an idea in terms of the scale that we're talking about, in terms of the antennas to be mounted to that. The antennas, as you can see from the photo and from the drawings, do not increase the height of the tower, and we hope that it and believe that what we're proposing is in keeping with the intent of the bylaws. I know we've been through this drawing a couple of times before. I'd be happy to answer any questions, but given that I know your schedule is tight this evening, that I'll try to keep my remarks brief and answer any questions you might have.
Thank you very much. At this point in time, I'd like to open the first of two public hearings. Or I suppose we can, yes, we should have two public hearings. Just one? We can combine two public hearings into one. And so at this point in time, I'd like to open the public hearing with regards to site plan review and RP3 zone certificate. Public hearing is now open. Would any member of the public care to step to the podium and give us some opinion or information or any ideas about the application? No. It's never too late. Seeing and hearing no public comment, I'll close the public hearings. Do it once. And we can now move on to substantive discussion of the merits of the application. Are there any questions or comments from board members? Yes.
I'd like to make a motion.
Yes, please.
Motion for the board to consider findings of fact number one. Ani Point is proposing to add antennas to an existing tower located at 351 Spurwink Ave, which requires site plan review and an RP3 permit. Number two, the application was deemed complete on May 21st, 1998, and a public hearing was held on June 16th, 1998. Number three, the town engineer has recommended that additional details be added to the plans. Number four, the application substantially complies with the standards of Section 19-9, site plan review, and Section 19-8-3, resource protection permit. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans, materials submitted, and the facts presented, the application of OmniPoint Corporations, MB Operations, LLC, for site plan review and an RP3 permit to install antenna on an existing tower located at 351 Spurwink Ave be approved, subject to the following conditions. Number one, that the plans be revised per the town engineer's letter dated May 7th, 1998, and submitted to the town engineer for approval. And two, that there be no alteration of the site nor building permit issued until the above condition has been met.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion on the motion? Yes, Tom.
I believe the application was deemed complete on May 19th. The 21st was a Thursday, if I'm not mistaken. And that's item two.
That's correct.
Any other items of discussion? Okay, we have a motion and a second, and the motion has been amended.
Accepted.
And the motion as amended is accepted. All those in favor of the motion indicate so by raising your right hand. It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Well, before we move on, I'd like to take this opportunity just to mention once again, in case anyone here is interested, that the item on the agenda following this one right now, the Cantor Lane, Morgan Lane application, has been withdrawn for this evening, and so we won't be seeing them this evening. and we are running a little bit behind, but we'll catch up a little bit now.
So you're putting a little pressure on the applicant here. Is a point of order, do you have to introduce the next application before I recuse myself, or can I simply recuse myself?
Mr. Emery, if you would like to address the board at this time concerning the next application, feel free.
As you know, I've recused myself in the past, and I will continue to recuse myself.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, David.
I have a conflict, too.
Yes, you both may be excused. Do we have anyone left here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We still have 5 voting members. I believe that's sufficient. So moving on, the next item on the agenda is the Sprague Master Plan Subdivision. A request by the Sprague Corporation for preliminary subdivision review of a 60-lot subdivision located south of Bowery Beach Road under Section 16-2-4, preliminary subdivision review. And if the applicant could come to the podium and give us an update when the applicant is ready, we will review current developments in that application next.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Once again, I'm Terry DeWan, a landscape architect in Yarmouth. With me is Amy Bell, another landscape architect of my firm, Seth Sprague from the Sprague Corporation, and John Green, property manager for Sprague Corporation, are here with us tonight. As you know, we have submitted a package of information dated May 29th, 1998. That was subsequently amended to address some further discussions that we've had with the fire chief and Maureen and other people, and that was dated June 8, 1998. What we would like to do is to summarize the discussion that we've had since the last meeting with the planning board, to talk a little bit about the changes that have been made, that are proposed to be made to the plan, specifically in the area of fire protection, road width, and other related issues. We feel that at this point that we have submitted a very complete application, and we would like to finish up by requesting that the board review the project and grant us preliminary subdivision approval after a discussion this evening. Thank you very much for having us back here. We hope not to darken your doorway too many more times in the future, but we feel that we really are making progress here. Having come to what we feel is a middle ground with the fire chief over the issues of fire protection and emergency access. We did meet with the chief on May 26th. We reviewed the plans. We talked to him in detail about the various aspects of the plan. And I think to sum it up, in my conversation with the chief today, he agrees that this is a major improvement over what is out there. We have made improvements, we feel, to the plan to address some of the concerns that we heard from the planning board at the last meeting. We'll talk about that as we go through here. We feel this has been a long process. It's been a fruitful process, one that has seen concessions on both sides, and we feel that the solutions that we've come up with not only address the needs of the town and the planning board, we also feel that these are solutions that are acceptable to the family, to the Sprague Corporation, that will allow them to do what they want to do with the property over the next several generations, while retaining the character of this very unique piece of property. And those really are the crux of the issues that we want to address tonight. In terms of making a presentation, Maureen has given us a staff memo dated today, and we'll simply go down addressing the points in her memo: sprinkled rocks, lots, road names, road widths, open space, wetland boundaries, the non-residential lot, and subsurface disposal. Sprinkler lots is one of the issues that we talked about in passing last time. We have prepared an illustrative plan that's on my right and your left that illustrates some of the points we're about to make. As I said, we did talk with the chief. We looked at other ordinances, Scarboroughs and Gorhams, found out what other towns are doing requiring additional measures to assist with fire protection. We are proposing at this time that a certain number of lots, 16 in all, 13 new lots and 6 existing structures as shown on this plan, would require any new construction, or in the case of existing homes, any reconstruction or expansion, to have a sprinkler system installed as part of that construction or reconstruction. These were based upon, again, the examination of other towns we're looking at. Those other towns looked at a number of 2,000 feet from a source of water or from a dry hydrant. We are measuring the 1,500 feet from the hydrant to the building envelope. We've identified these lots. These are the ones that are shown on the plan. This would be submitted to the town as part of their final subdivision approval. Notes would be added to the plan, not only where the houses would be required as part of new construction, but also in the existing structures that would meet this requirement. So that's, I think, a very important component of our overall fire protection plan, that there would be a certain number of homes that would be sprinklered that are in areas that are beyond 1,500 feet from the source of water, as we're showing here. Road names is the next point that was brought out in Maureen's memo. We have submitted the road names that were brought before you the last time to the E911 committee. We have had a number of comments. We will be making some changes to the road names. We did receive a letter dated June 11, 1998, from David Pickering, the chief of police and head of the committee. Some of them we feel are fairly minor, but I think they would be important in the case of an emergency. For example, most of these involve changing the word road to either trail or lane. So you're going to be keeping the general intent of the proposed names that we have out here, but making the changes that the fire chief and the police chief have recommended. A copy of this letter, has this letter been given to the planning board? This will be submitted to the town then. And a quote from the chief of police: "We see only minor problems with three of the Sprague Corporation selections. All of the road names have been approved as being of no concern to the committee." Road widths is probably the most important issue that we really have to bring before the board. As you know, last time we presented a number of different options. We batted back and forth a variety of different road widths and situations. And when we talk about road widths, the majority of our discussion has to do with the emergency access loop that we've talked about and reviewed in the field. Our proposal now, as stated in our letter of June 8th, is to increase the minimum width of our emergency loop roads from 12 feet, which is what we had talked about last time, to what we're calling the monastery road standards. If you recall, when we did our tour out on the property, we drove down Little Pond Lane, we came out to Monastery Road, and most people said, "Wow, this is a very nice big road." That road is basically a 16-foot wide road. In some places, 18-foot wide. It's never any narrower than 16 feet wide. In places, Monastery Road has turnouts, especially at curves. In some places, they've done some minor logging along the way. The character of the emergency access road then that we're proposing in most locations would be the same as the Monastery Road as it goes in from Bowery Beach Road down to the end of the property. This is something that the family of the corporation talked long and hard about. We feel it's a standard that can be met. It's possible to upgrade portions of the road as part of the emergency loop in such a way that maintains the character of the property. We are asking that two exceptions to the Monastery Road standard be allowed as part of the overall plan. First of all, in a few locations, for example, along Japanese Pond Road and a little bit of wetland area on the lower side of Japanese Pond Road, with our wetlands on either side of the road, we want to make sure that the roadway minimizes the impacts on the wetlands. In those areas, the road now is probably in the 10 to 12 foot wide width. We want to make sure that road does not go more than 12 feet in width. There are also four specific locations that we would like to keep the road at its current width or 12 feet wide to preserve significant trees. And as part of the package that we gave you on June 8th, we showed you those four very specific locations. In some places, for example, on lot 8.8, There's a group of large, old evergreen trees that are probably 2.5 to 3 feet in diameter, really signaled the entrance way to that particular piece of property. If we were to expand the road from the current 10 to 12 feet wide up to this, the Monastery Road standard, we'd probably lose 2, possibly 3 of those trees by keeping the road narrow at that point. It's a small pinch point. That would really maintain the character of the road at that particular location. We are talking about only 4 situations like that where it does occur. We've indicated where those are, Little Pond Lane, and on Japanese, and on that Monastery Road, where that situation does occur. We talked a little bit last time about adjusting the geometry of the pull-offs. We had a sketch last time, I believe, it's shown on this plan right here, that shows a hypothetical taper. I know that the town engineer, Steve Harding, suggests that we work a little bit more carefully with him to adjust the length of the taper. We're certainly willing to do that, working with Steve and with the fire chief to make sure that there's an adequate amount of room here. They're not quite as sharp as are shown in the diagram there to allow 2 vehicles to pass without any difficulty. Again, given the uniqueness of the property, we feel this is a proper response, and we're working both with Steve and the fire chief to make sure that there are the pull-offs, turnouts in the appropriate locations using the design as recommended by Mr. Harding. The final design for these pull-offs, the location, the widths, and so forth will be depicted on the final plan. Outside of the loop road system, the roads will be built to the Monastery Road standard where the roads serve more than 2 homes. There are a couple of exceptions to that. There always seems to be an exception to these rules here. One exception, of course, is the Ice Pond Road. We've already represented to the board that would be an 18-foot wide road. Secondly, there are a number of situations throughout where we have essentially long driveways that serve 2 lots, 2 potential house sites. And we feel that because these really are large driveways, that it doesn't make sense to treat those as the large-scale road the Monastery Road represents. And our proposal is to construct those to a 12-foot wide width, essentially what you would normally expect to see for a driveway. Open space. A note will be added to the final plan stating that, and this is some wording that we've worked out with the corporation, and I quote, "During the life of the Sprague Corporation, shareholders have the right to the use of the property pursuant to the terms of their shareholders' agreement, which will be available for use by family members." And this is something which we can talk more about. Seth Sprague is here to address any questions that you may have regarding the use of the open space on the property by the family members. Maureen had a question about wetland boundaries. In our submittals, we gave you additional information on the wetland mapping for a number of lots, 5-8, 9-1, 9-2, 10-1, and 10-2, and 10-3. Woodlot Alternatives has specifically addressed this issue in their letter dated May 28th, which is part of the package that was given to you. The wetland boundaries have been determined and will be depicted on our final submission. I know that John Green met with Maureen this afternoon. Maureen has asked us to clarify some of the graphics on our plan to make sure that it's crystal clear where the boundaries are between the wetlands, the wetland boundaries, and the soils. I think that we have all the information. I think at this point, simply a matter of making sure that the graphics are clear enough so that it's very obvious to all parties just where lines need to be measured from and where those boundaries occur. Woodlot Alternatives has, in the process of doing their work, double-checked all the buffers surrounding the RP1 wetlands. Next issue is non-residential lot. There is one lot, lot 5.4, which is a non-residential lot. It's this lot right here. There's a small collection of buildings there which have been used for a variety of agricultural purposes over the years. This is a collection of buildings that will be encompassed by lot 5.4, but will not be available to be used for residential purposes. The lot is being placed around these structures and the accompanying fields for lease purposes. The next point has to do with subsurface disposal. Alfrick Associates, who's the soils people who were doing the work for us, has found a passing test pit on each lot, with the exception of one lot, lot 9.1. We've talked about this in the past. However, there is a test pit and a septic location that was found outside of the lot boundary. There will be a septic easement that will be provided as part of the final subdivision application to the planning board. Alfrick has returned to the field and has finished his work. The work necessary to verify the location of the passing test pits and the septic sites for each of the proposed lots. The information that is being collected by Mr. Frick right now will be forwarded to the code enforcement officer as part of the final subdivision application for his review and approval. We feel then that that is a summary of all the changes that have been made to the plan since we appeared before you the last time. At this point, we feel that we have met all the requirements necessary for preliminary approval under the terms of the town's subdivision ordinance and the comprehensive plan. At this point, we really hope that the board finds the subdivision application meets the terms of the ordinance and the comprehensive plan, and we're able to move beyond the conceptual stage and allow us then, as part of the application for final subdivision approval, to start working out the details of the roads, the turnouts, and so forth, and come back before you in a month or two for a final subdivision review. We feel that throughout this process, we've had a good relationship with you and the town staff. We've come to a reasonable middle ground that allowed this plan to work both from the family's perspective and from the town's perspective. At this point, we'd be glad to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, Alexander.
Mr. Wink, I'm very satisfied with the new submission. I think particularly the sprinklers goes a long way to solving the problems we have with the narrow road network. And certainly, you don't want to make the roads any wider than we have to. The sprinklers takes care of that. One issue I have, I'd like you to review where we stand on 110, 19, and 18. Those lots that we're going to have that long driveway. How is that issue being resolved?
110, 19, and 18. Okay, we have Trelawney Lake Trail coming off of Fowler Road right here. This would be a 16-foot wide road. Down to the hammerhead right there, and then people would have a long driveway that they would have to gain access to their property. Excuse me. For Amy here, more involved in details there.
You have a copy of the most recent plan in front of you here. Yeah. Okay, yeah.
So I was referring to an old plan. One of the dangers of using old graphics here.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, we have that blue.
That's right. That's the question that you're involved with right now. How do we get beyond this? We do have that blue that's down here.
Good. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Why did you choose 1,500 feet, houses 1,500 feet or further away from a pond or for the sprinkler systems?
Yes.
Why that distance? Is that as long as the...
We were guided by what we saw in other ordinances, which had 2,000 feet. We wanted something a little bit better than that. I'll ask. That's essentially it. There's no magic number. There's no rule of thumb other than the fact that we've looked at other ordinances and felt that 1,500 was simply a little bit better than other communities.
Okay. Thank you. I'm just curious, how long are the hoses of the fire department? Does anybody know? Well, the newest and the best.
1,000 feet. Or more, did you say? 1,000 feet or more?
1,000 feet
on each engine. And it's possible to hook engines together.
Yes, 1,000 feet engine goes in on that line of the conveyor.
So you could conceivably have that pipe fire 2,000 feet away from the source of the water by pumping it, pumper to pumper. Yeah. Is that a fairly common practice? But
thank you for sharing.
Are there any other aspects of the plans that we should take a look at this point? Yes, Stephen.
I have a motion to make.
Oh, please proceed.
Motion for the board to consider findings of fact. Number one, the Sprague Corporation is proposing a major subdivision including 62 plus or minus lots, which requires review under section 16-3-1, subdivision standards section 19-8-3, resource protection performance standards, and section 19-7-9, private access provisions. Number two, the fire chief has recommended sprinkling for homes where public water supply is not available for fire protection. Number three, the use of similar sounding street names has hampered public safety efforts. Number four, the turnouts designed by the applicant may be problematic for emergency vehicle usage. Number five, the subdivision ordinance standards require the open space be set aside to maintain the current ratio of permanently protected open space to resident. Number six, wetland boundaries are typically determined using soil types, but may also be established using plant types and hydrology. Number seven, lots that will not be available for residential or single-family development should be clearly labeled on the plan to avoid confusion. Number eight, submission of passing test pit data for each lot is necessary to demonstrate that subsurface disposal that meets health standards may be possible in each lot. Number nine, the application substantially complies with the standards of section 16-3-1, subdivision standards, section 19-8-3, resource protection performance standards, and section 19-7-9, private access provisions. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Sprague Corporation for major subdivision review, a resource protection permit, and private access waivers for the 62 plus or minus lot Sprague master plan subdivision located south of Bowery Beach Road be approved subject to the following conditions. Number one, that all lots which will have sprinkler systems installed be identified on the plan. Number two, that all road names be approved by the E-911 committee. Number three, that the turnouts be revised per the town engineer's letter dated 6/9/98. Number four, that a note be added to the plan stating that the entire estate is available to family members for open space. Number five, that revised wetland mapping be provided where wetland boundaries do not match wetland soil boundaries. Number six, that a note be added to lot 5-4 that is not a residential lot. Number seven, that test pit information be provided to the code enforcement officer demonstrating that at least one passing test pit exists for each lot except lot 9-1, and number eight, that the plans be revised and there be no application for final subdivision review until the above conditions have been met.
Mr. Wilcox, may I second?
Oh, Nancy May.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion?
I have to ask for a clarification.
Yes. I know
for an amendment on point number four, that read, a note be added to the plan saying the entire estate be available to the family members for open space. But clearly, some of the individual lots would not be available, and we would like to have that reworded to say that, quote, during the life of the Sprague Corporation, shareholders have the right to the use of the property pursuant to the terms of the shareholders' agreement, which will be available for use by family members.
That's been read into the record, I don't have to repeat that. That's acceptable to me.
Okay.
To me. We have 2 seconds.
Okay, any further discussion? We have a motion which has been seconded and amended, and the amendment has been accepted. With no further discussion then, all those in favor of the motion as amended indicate so by raising your right hand. It has received minor subdivision preliminary approval. Congratulations, and we look forward to seeing you again someday. The next item on the agenda this evening is the Maxwell Farm Irrigation Pond Enlargement, a request by Maxwell's Farm for a resource protection permit to enlarge an existing irrigation pond located behind 1020 and 1022 Sawyer Road under section 19-8-3, Resource Protection Permit Completeness and Public Hearing. If the applicant could come to the podium and tell us a little bit about what's involved.
Good evening. My name is Bill Bamford. I am the farm manager at Maxwell's. I'm not sure why I'm standing in front of you tonight asking for approval for an irrigation pond. But like everyone else in the room, I am also hoping for drier days ahead. Currently behind 1020 and 1022 Sawyer Road on property which is owned by Ken and Elsie Maxwell, there is a small irrigation pond that has been there for a period of years. I'm not sure how long. It's approximately 40 feet wide and 175 feet long. Although there is another irrigation pond on that same property, it's on the other side of the property and too far away to adequately care for the water needs on this side of the farm. So we need more water over there. My request is to have approval to enlarge it in 2 stages. The first stage only would be done if that takes care of our water needs. The second stage would not be completed. Each stage proposed would be an additional 40 feet of width in the pond, and it would be maintained at the same length. And at the same time, there would be no changes to either the inlet or the discharge side or to the water level in the area.
Thank you very much. To open the discussion, I guess, first of all, it's probably a good point to just make note that the reason the application is here at the board is because it involves work in a wetland. However, there is a special provision in the ordinance for this type of work, which allows it to proceed, given our blessing. And so, given the information presented at this point in time, does anybody have any questions about what's involved? Yes, Stephen.
I'd like to make a motion.
Thank you.
Motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Maxwell's Farm for resource protection permit to enlarge an existing irrigation pond located behind 1020 and 1022 Sawyer Road be deemed complete.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second, Mr. O'Connell.
Okay, thank you, Peter. Any further discussion? Mr. Emery?
I'll agree to deem it complete, but I would find it helpful if there were a copy of a USGS map of the area that the pond is affected, so that the board can see if there's any streams or any other related items that can be submitted to the planner after the meeting. Doesn't need to be done now, as far as I'm concerned.
Okay. Any further comments regarding completeness? Well, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor of the motion indicate by raising your right hand. Okay, it's unanimous. The application is deemed complete. Is there further discussion then at this point on substantive aspects of the application? Yes, Tom.
I'll ask a question. I think I know the answer to it, but I'll ask it anyway. Why aren't you digging it deeper instead of wider? Is there ledge? Have you hit ledge or something?
There's probably some ledge there somewhere. We haven't run into it yet. It's a matter of time before you run into ledge in this town. Basically, it's at a depth now where to dig it deeper would increase the slopes on the sides of the pond, which would only increase potential inflows from outside. Anytime rainwater flows in, it would make a very steep side on the pond.
Any other aspects of the application to review at this point? Yes.
Just a curious, out of curiosity, what do you intend to do with the spoils? Do you spread it?
The fill that we remove?
Yeah.
It will have to be removed. Several years ago, we got approval to dig a pond in the Two Lights area that was dug in several stages. What happened down there was we would remove the soil. It needed to be on the ground for a while to dry out and to be usable. A lot of that down there, people use it to backfill around houses. There was one house in particular down there that needed a lot of fill, and they got a very good deal on some fill because that meant we didn't have to haul it off.
So that soil does not have any special nutrients in it that would be advantageous for the strawberries?
No. Most of it is subsoil. There's very little topsoil, and so most of it is okay. Not useful as far as agriculture.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, are we doing a public hearing?
We are doing a public hearing, if we so desire, this evening. We did make preparations for it last month. So I guess at this point in time, just to gauge public input for this project, I'd like to open a public hearing. Any member of the public who would be interested in offering comment or opinion on the proposed project, please step to the podium.
Hello, Mr. Chairman. My name is John Green. I'm a member of the Conservation Commission.
Yes.
I believe the commission did forward a memo. I'm not sure if the update the updated information has been sent to you. Essentially, on Saturday morning, several members of the Conservation Commission went out to the site to review the project and in the driving rain, and in doing so, found there to be no major issues with wetlands or other concerns with that regard. I believe our only major concern in reviewing the application last Thursday was the need maybe for a bit of additional information regarding maybe streams, just a bit of better information so that we can determine whether there are shoreline zoning setbacks or other setbacks involving streams or associated wetlands, but we didn't find anything. Any problems with the site walk itself, so
okay.
We find it looks okay.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. Would anyone else like to offer comment from during the public hearing? Okay, well, seeing none, hearing none at this point, I'll close the public hearing. And we can then return to discussion by the board. Yes.
I'd like to make a motion. Motion for the board to consider.
Do you have a question?
No, I was going to make a motion, but.
Oh, sorry.
I tried to preempt the public hearing.
Findings of fact. Number one, Maxwell Farm proposes to enlarge an existing irrigation pond located behind 1020 and 1022 Sawyer Road, which requires a resource protection permit. Number two, the application was deemed complete at the June 16th, 1998 Planning Board meeting and a public hearing was held. Number three, stabilization of excavated material is necessary to prevent erosion. Number four, the application substantially complies with Section 19-8-3 Resource Protection Permit. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Maxwell's Farm for a resource protection permit to enlarge an existing irrigation pond located behind 1020 and 1022 Sawyer Road be approved with the following conditions. Number one, that the excavated areas be stabilized after construction in accordance with the revegetation and stabilization standards established in the March 1991 Maine Erosion and Sediment Control Handbook for Construction Best Management Practices, and number two, that the applicant consider creating a bench or flattening the slope near the edge of the pond to provide a transition area to facilitate exiting the pond. I'm not quite sure if I understand that. Who's going to be exiting the pond?
Someone who inadvertently falls in.
Oh, okay, fine. That's great.
Okay, we have a motion.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion at this point?
I'd just like to clarify a fact for Mr. Parkhurst. One of the reasons why it's necessary to exit the pond, being in a butter of Max Wolf's farm, is my dog swims in that pond, and it's very hard for him to climb up the banks.
Thank you for that clarification. Is that that dog with just the two hind legs?
No. Now we know. We have further discussion.
I have a question.
Yes, Tom.
Does this require a state NRPA permit?
Oh, that's a good question for Maureen.
I have no idea.
Could we just add another condition of approval that, if so, that permit be provided prior to construction?
RP what?
Natural Resource Protection Act permit for alteration of wetlands.
Okay.
Okay. Good. We have any discussion on the proposed?
One question. You're not planning on doing the excavation until next winter, if I remember correctly from the workshop. Is that correct?
If we haven't floated away, we'll probably attempt it in the fall of the year.
Okay.
Probably not in the wintertime, fall.
Okay.
Yes, we have an amendment that can be discussed at this point and would need to be either accepted or declined.
Seconded and then accepted.
Second. Is the amendment second?
I second it.
Seconded.
Okay.
And
accepted.
And accepted.
Accepted.
Okay. We now have a motion that has been amended and accepted. All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. And the motion passes. Congratulations. Thank you very much.
And I want to say that Mr. Maxwell was terrific on TV tonight.
And the final application this evening is the Bluestone Quarry Earth Materials Permit Renewal. A request by Leland P. Murray for renewal of an earth materials permit for Bluestone Quarry located at 1019 Sawyer Road under section 19-8-5, earth materials permit public hearing. The applicant has come to the podium, and if you could present to us your purpose this evening.
Thank you. My name is Jim Murray, president of the Bluestone Corporation, which owns the rock quarry at 1019 Sawyer. I have checked the perimeter. The fence is all intact. I have installed new signs that come down yearly. And to my knowledge, there's been no complaints from any of the neighbors for the activity that's gone on.